Hello, welcome everyone. Thank you for waiting. Thank you for joining us today in a sort of rainy, gloomy afternoon. And you've probably had a chance to meet everybody. John, the artist, Frances, who's written a wonderful text for the exhibition, and myself, Juan Bolivar, representing sort of Team Turps. So what I thought we could do is have a little chat. But before, I think it'd be quite nice to create some of the context for the exhibition coming together. So I hope it doesn't feel like it's too much like a history lesson, art history lesson, although it's like a sort of slow build-up. But I think it's really important to create that context of the sort of antecedents leading up to this point. So I'm going to take it back in time. It's like a sort of hypnotist and therapist. I'm going to take it back in time. So it's going to be something like 1989, and you're an Indian.
Okay.
You weren't expecting that, were you? You're in India, and you're doing lots of drawings, lots of sketches. You did your BA at Cheltenham, is that correct?
Yep.
You did a BA at Cheltenham. And then you went to India, and you were kind of thinking, how do I become an artist? How do I make work? How do I progress my practice? And you take a sketchbook, which becomes really fundamental to your future, because it's a sketchbook that then Paul Huxley finds particularly interesting at your interview at the Royal College, and you gain a place at the Royal College. Spend a couple of years making a variety of work, including some of the first hanging paintings.
Not at college.
But begin work that leads to the...
I did one picture which had a hanging object in it,
okay.
But I look back, I kind of forget about that, but I remember.
Okay,
that
well, I remember. And and to cut the long story short, you have a degree show, as you do at the end of sort of these courses, and there's a note that you find on your space, a note saying, call...
Charles Saatchi.
Yeah, or calls CS, in fact.
Somebody handed it me.
Somebody sent him there. And to cut the long story short again, that sort of then sort of meeting or incident that leads to your inclusion in what's probably one of the most sort of seminal exhibitions for our generation, which is the first YBA exhibition, Boundary Road. And works were displayed from works that sort of Saatchi had been putting together loosely under this sort of now sort of shark infested waters group of artists, some of which were then selected and shown in the first YBA show, including yourself. Mm-hmm. So starting from that point, just tell us a little bit, how did that feel? How crazy was that? You know, Shark, John Greenwood, Sarah Lucas, I mean, just, you know.
In some ways, it didn't feel as crazy as it should do. I think when I look back on it, it should have felt crazy. I tend to find that the sense of being an artist is such a quiet, not necessarily lonely, but it's something you do on your own. So most of the time, that's what you're doing. And you realise that there's this whole world going on around you that is beginning to take a bit of notice. But actually what I did didn't change. You know, you'd come out of the studio and you'd go off and have a private view in the Saatchi Gallery, and then the next day you'd be back in the studio. You know, it didn't seem as different as I expected it to. My life remained exactly the same, but just you suddenly have these little incidents, or, you know, you go off in the Sunday Times like to interview you and photograph you, and then you go back to being what you've always been in a way. So there's a madness to it, but it's also that only exists like 1% of what you're doing. The rest of it's roughly the same.
Yeah.
And it didn't really seem to change very much. You know, I mean, the thing I was talking about to someone recently was that at the private view of the first YBA show, everybody went off to a nightclub, and I wasn't invited. And so me and all my friends went round the corner to the pub, and I didn't think anything of it. But
right.
I think that had I gone to the nightclub, it would have felt madder. You know, had I but just going to the pub was just like going to the pub with a bunch of friends.
Do you know what nightclub they went to?
They didn't tell me. I
Okay.
And maybe that's not how it happened, but that's my kind of memory as creator. It's a long time ago. Really. So, but they, there was a sense that they kind of all knew each other. Mm. Or that's what it felt like. There was a kind of group. And I think probably because a lot of them did know each other.
That's from the sort of goldsmiths.
It may well have been a kind of goldsmiths or all college thing. I think it was that they were a much more social bunch than I was. You know, so I had a little group of friends and I just kept carrying them around, or they kept carrying me around. And so I think that that sense of the madness was less of it. So it felt quite ordinary in a way. I mean, it's the, you know, the process of being a painter stays the same, and it's one where most of the time you've got your head kind of buried in your own studio, and that just kept going. Mm. And I think that part was my, you know, what I now look back on and think that I didn't make the most of that, and it's because I think I kept painting when I should have been out.
Clubbing,
yeah. I think that's probably true, really. So.
And it's interesting because we've talked about this before, where, you know, how did you feel about the work that was being presented from those goldsmith sort of students and the work that you were making, which to a certain extent, I mean, but I don't entirely think so, but to a certain extent it's, you know, what you would describe as more traditional painting. Mm-hmm. And sort of how do you feel about that sort of juxtaposition of different tendencies?
I think, again, it's one of those things that when I look back, I should have realised how different it was. But it was just, I had a space, you know, somebody was showing a shark next to me, somebody was showing, you know, the inside of a room slightly further down the corridor. I didn't realise that my paintings were that different. You know, it's just they were, you know, there's an artist fresh out of college, there's another one. And I think when I look back, I think you can kind of see that I should have been slightly more in awe of the fact that someone had a huge, great shark. You know, it's going to get the attention. Whereas someone who kind of uses small brushes to make quite big paintings was just, it didn't fit, I think. I remember speaking to Andrew Graham Dixon, who was interviewing us for The Late Show or something, and him just saying, "You seem different." And I didn't know what he meant. And I think at the time, I kind of misunderstood what he meant. I kind of took it as some kind of weird compliment that I was somehow different, you know. It's like, you're
And it could be a compliment.
It might be, I don't think it was.
I think it was
quite the opposite. You don't fit in, so.
You don't pickle stuff.
Yeah.
But you paint pickled
things. I could have pickled stuff. Somebody got
Does anybody here remember going to the show, or just to get it? No. No, nobody went to the show.
My wife remembers. Robert does.
Okay, I went to the show. Yeah, I was studying painting at the time.
They're all too young.
Well, I was, I don't know, I was 19 at the time, or something, 20.
Yeah.
And it felt like a real kind of, it's a little bit like going to Turps, you know, in those days, going to the Boundary Road. You had to go out of the way, middle of nowhere, and sort of, it was sort of like a gated sort of gallery, and you bust the little bell and you went in and there was this other
supermodels walking around, as I remember, pop stars
queuing up, you know. And so that's kind of to a certain extent part of the context of this show. And there's sort of then the second part is I guess the point when you know, you continue exhibiting and, you know, having what could be described as quite a sort of successful career until the late 90s, then when you essentially go into hibernation, you decide for reasons that you might want to share or not, you know, you decide to essentially
think. Here at the back.
Is the team Helen kids here?
My kids, you know,
are here. You decide to sort of like basically, I mean, you always did a lot of drawing. I mean, drawing has always been constant, but you stopped.
I stopped doing anything.
You stopped drawing.
No, for a long time, when the kids are little, I don't have time to think. Mm. I remember getting on a bus once. You know, I would go into town, the kids, you know, staying in a kind of rare night out, and just sitting on this bus and thinking, I don't have to think of anything except what I want now. And it was just this bizarre thought of just being so constantly busy and taken up by, you know, the challenges of just looking after two other people. Mm. But just, you didn't have time to think. So, not everybody would be like that, but that's how it kind of hit me for a while. So, so I didn't draw, I didn't paint for 12 to 14 years, I think it was. So, Actually, that's not true, because when I started again, and I got enough space when the kids were in school and so on, I decided to have a go, you know, because I'd spent so long, thousands of hours, reading kids' books to them, and looking at these thinking, I could do that. And so my wife said, well, you keep talking about it, why don't you do it? So the first thing I did is I thought, I'll just spend a month, I'll do a series of kids' books and illustrations in my head, and I tried to do it. And that month kind of got spread to about 2.5 years. So when I did start working, it wasn't as a painter, you know, as I saw it.
You were thinking even of like making illustrations.
I thought that if I made a kid's book, it would give me enough money so I could paint. You know, I thought this would be some kind of pot of gold. And of course, it's like every other pot of gold.
With its own complexities.
Yeah, its own difficulties, which are every bit as great as the ones I already knew about and had kind of bound in front of those forces. So I got somebody who was an agent. The process seemed to be you get an agent. Somebody who was vaguely interested said, well, if you change this and change that. And I thought, well, so that month turned into 6 months, turned into, went back to her and said no, and, you know, actually, I'm not interested. But then somebody else was interested. And then the stubbornness kept sticking at it. Thinking, I just got to knock on one more door and try, you know, one more. And eventually, after 2.5 years, I realised I'm no nearer. And I'm not doing what I want to do. And also, the illustrations were quite... My wife kept saying, they're really scary. You know, they're not for kids. They're not for kids. You can't take that kind of element of blackness out of them. Yeah, it's like, yeah, you're going to give them nightmares. And I thought, well, surely that's what they want.
The kids what they want.
Yeah, so,
beautiful, yeah. Beautiful job. Anyways...
But the great thing with that is that having kind of put that back and think, right, I'll, you know, go back to doing what I want to do, and just accept I've wasted 2.5 precious years, is that actually is something that I think really helped my work when I started again. That I'd been spending this time trying to learn how to cartoon, how to do simplified faces. And I've never done faces
wax
before.
Wax off, Karate Kid,
yeah. No, I could have done, but
I missed the reference there.
But just generally kind of drawing from illustration and really kind of enjoying
it. You'd been preparing, going through the motions before the...
Yeah. Well, just learning how to do a different skill and thinking, you know, and that actually is something that I'm really grateful for, because it brought, it made me, I've never used expressions before in my work. I'd referred to the human body always, but I'd never ever used it as such. It was always kind of bits from or bits similar to.
Okay.
So it's actually really, I think, gave me a breakthrough.
And that's around by this point, 90. What were we?
Probably about 2.5 years ago.
2.5 years. Okay. So it's more or less at that point that then, again, we're edging closer to sort of today, sort of November 12, 2016, and it's at this point that then the CNC show comes about, which is in a sense your kind of return to, you know, to exhibiting, to painting as you once did, and the thing about that show is that it was partly some older works and two new paintings that you've made. So it was almost like a nice bridge between what had happened before.
Yeah.
And
some of the paintings were the paintings that I'd made, you know, just before I kind of stopped, as I was kind of slowing down, that hadn't been shown in this country. I'd had a gallery out in Germany, which had about 3 galleries in about a year shut on me. And they were one of, and so these paintings have been shown out there, but never shown here. Had come back from Germany, and then the ones that hadn't sold, and then just kind of gone into the garage.
Mm.
So they, you know, they were old paintings, but they, you know, they haven't been seen.
Mm. So the thing about this show,
okay, which is here, that didn't take long, that
which is sort of, in a sense, quite special, quite unique, is that, you know, everything here, everything that you see today, has been made specifically for this show,
yeah,
and it's probably then the first time in London that's happened,
definitely.
And it's also happened in a relatively quick time. I mean, I think you've made them in about 8 weeks. Every time we talk, you say 6, 5. I think you say you're going to make them 2 weeks now, but
I should tell the truth because I can't remember.
Yeah,
now,
I think it's about 8 weeks roughly from beginning to all the works were made in sort of 8 weeks, including the one.
These two, I think, were done in about May. The nearest two here, but everything else was done. They were drawn out, then went away on holiday, came back from holiday, realising this show was here, panicked, and did them really quickly. I thought, you know, I'm going to end up with a show with 4 paintings in it, and you kept kind of coming and shouting at me, So I worked harder and faster than I had done before. I don't know why they'd taken me so long before. So it used to take about a month each. These took 3 weeks to a month, you know, 3 weeks just to paint, say a week to, you know, draw out and so on. Mm-hmm. And then the rest of them, I've taken about a week each. Mm-hmm. So just because I had to, right, to fill the space.
And Frances, so this is also more or less the time that you met John, is that correct, for a show that you curated in?
Yeah, before he went on holiday. I've been doing a programme of about 3 exhibitions, and John came up to me at another event entirely, introduced himself, and I then said, can I come round and saw the work, and then you were in the last exhibition, to cut a long story. So that's really where I've got to know you. And part of that exhibition was also to do with actually engaging in conversation and correspondence with the artists. Some of the other artists involved in those shows are here, which is great. And so the process leading up to the exhibition also meant that I'm the enormous privilege of getting to know people, not well, but sufficiently well that it makes the show more meaningful, I think, and also that in the exchanges I've had with artists that other things start coming about, like have you read this or have you seen this and this sort of thing.
Because you've written particularly about still life, is that correct?
So John was invited into that show because I think this has come up with somebody else particularly that I've exhibited, and that is that I could put that work in another show and you wouldn't necessarily think of it as still life. And you might come in here and think this is not still life. You might think it's more to do with, I don't know, quite sort of esoteric, whimsical or all sorts of other things, but you wouldn't necessarily think of it as still life. So I thought that it fitted quite well as a version of still life. And the reason for that is simply that they are objects, however strange. They're composite objects, and they are presented in relation to a surface. Sometimes they're hanging, sometimes they're sitting on the surface, but it's a very shallow space in which they reside. So in many ways it complies with some of the notions of still life. And I know that from having talked and written with John as well, that you actually do look at... you look at painters of the early modern period, a Northern Renaissance, sort of what we might call Northern Renaissance. But also you particularly like...
What do you mean by the modern period?
Early modern period, so 16th, okay, early 17th century. And also you particularly like to look at people like Bosch and Bruegel and...
And in terms of still life, in particular the sort of bodygon tradition of hanging paintings, you know, which is in some ways these Cotan here, which these sort of borrow, that, so they're not still lives, but they kind of, they borrow elements.
I mean, I call them my still lives just as a kind of a shorthand for them, because there's other bodies of work which aren't here, which I don't spend as much time developing at the moment, which are far more to do with movement or cartooning or kind of single images. So these I just lazily call them that. I don't know whether they are still. I think quite interesting, the show that I was in recently in Cardiff that Frances curated, even though it was called Still Life, about Still Life, I reckon that it was as much about the body that the artist chosen were seemingly, again, if you hadn't had the title, you could have called it, if you hadn't got body art, but kind of certainly referencing that. And there was this kind of crossover between still life and kind of life painting often.
I think what's so interesting is that still life traditionally, as most people know, came pretty low on the hierarchy of genres.
It was bottom.
Underneath it were miniature paintings, which women did. But I think...
But women did still life as well.
They did, and in fact, and Clara Peters, who's at in Madrid at the moment, big exhibition, but I think what is really interesting about what you might call contemporary still life, which arguably is different from the 99% of other still life, which you can find on the internet with no problems, is that it is contemporary still life seems to be actively searching for another partner And as you mentioned with the body, but it was really interesting working with those artists, because it, sometimes it might reference, well, not maybe not even reference, but might become more like landscape. Sometimes it becomes corporeal in some sort of way. Or people like Louise Briley, where if you look closely up at the paintings, they're like cake decoration, or you know, kids playing and scratching through plasticine or whatever, or Johnny Green. So in that sense, these comply with certain criteria where you might call them a still life.
Mm-hmm.
But I think what's interesting about them is the way they push and shove at the limits of the genre, and also interfering with the boundaries between genres.
I'm trying to think, when I look back, if you go into the National Gallery and you look at their kind of Dutch still life rooms, areas,
mm-hmm.
I don't see those as still lives. I don't know whether that's just me. They already seem to be pushing...
I think
outwards.
They are.
The reference isn't just to objects. The objects is what they're ostensibly about. Maybe why they were bought or collected, whatever. But they always seem to bleed into something else. I'm not always sure what that is.
But I think that comes out of early modern still life. So if we're talking about late 16th century, early 17th century flower painting, and you may know that there was a Rachel Roysch exhibition recently at the National Gallery, that... it is a criteria for the viewer of those paintings to be able to, they may see a bunch of flowers, and then there's all sorts of things about that as well. But actually, what they want to be able to do is scan the picture. So today you might look at this flower, another day you might look at that flower or whatever. And I think also what's really interesting about those paintings and the floral still lifes, which sounds terribly boring until you really get into it, which may be a bit sad, is that because those flowers in those bouquets don't all flower at the same season, in a sense they're all ready to do with artifice, then you also realise that each of those flowers has been studied individually and brought into the painting. So actually there's no logical perspective in the whole painting either. And that stops it being a monolith, in a sense. It makes it more something that you constantly do this, which is something that seems to happen, or is a tension that seems to be happening in your paintings. Whereas these, particularly one on the left, your eye isn't drawn into any one particular point. But then others you have where this is really quite... you've got nowhere else to go, literally, because there's no other object to look at apart from this object that is breaking up and all the sort of metaphorical associations there. But also it has nowhere to go, and I've made this point with you when we've talked and corresponded, that pretty much all John's work that I've seen is always in this very enclosed space. And you just won't let anybody out anywhere. You've either got to come into this painting and play the game, or there isn't anything there. And I think that does link up a little bit with still lives. But I think this is something else which I think is really interesting about these, which is an older notion of 16th century, and mannerists, and mannerist poets, and these sorts of people are very interested in this. And that is this notion of serious play. Because somebody has written about you that you're doing works which are comical, and I think that may be wrong.
Yeah, but I think there's humour in there intentionally.
Humour, but are we talking about wit or are we talking about comic? Are they comic?
I don't know. I mean,
there's something, maybe they're fake dark.
But dark humour. But I don't know whether it's comical or wit. I don't know, you know, what the differences are. It's an important aspect, I think, of them that I think they would fall flat or be quite uninterestingly dark. In the way, one of the things I worry about when I put this show together and you kind of see it in the studio as it's finally built and you're about to package it to come here, and I kind of thought, is this, you know, I don't consider myself a person who constantly dwells on the negative. And I think one of the ways of reading these pictures is that they're aesthetically quite black. There's a lot of black in them. It's the single thing that if you look and you scan them, I kind of thought, have I ever done this? That's a set of paintings. I might begin to take that out. But I also thought, is it like such a dystopian vision of people and the world we live in? And I would hope that it's not. And I think that some element of colour brings that out, away from that slightly. But I think that the humour is the thing that may be that kind of laughing at a situation, you know, the Donald Trump, kind of the fact that you despair when Donald Trump you know, becomes elected president. And I think we probably all assume that we do that. And I think the fact you start finding things immediately on Facebook and the internet, which just, you know, take the piss out of him. This figure who has such potential, awful power, it becomes slightly, you know, maybe that's the only thing you can do left is to laugh, because all other power seems to be pulled from us. But I think what's good about people is sometimes the humour, the fact that they're not too serious. And I think that whether it's wit or I mean, something when I'm drawing in my sketchbooks, I'm on my own and the rest of the family's gone off to do what they do during the day, and I'm there with my cup of coffee. If I can make myself laugh out loud, that image gets used, even if I don't even know what it's about. Literally, if as I'm doing, I'm kind of pursuing some kind of notion or drawing or a few shapes, and something happens that makes me laugh, whether that's wit or comedy or whatever, I don't know. I just think that has grabbed me in some way that is interesting, and I will nearly always use that, as opposed to all the other ideas which kind of, you know, disappear.
John,
you know.
That kind of brings me quite sort of nicely to one painting that perhaps we could start even talking about the show more specifically, but perhaps starting with the one painting which the show is titled after, which in some ways sort of formally doesn't quite follow so much the idea of the sort of cell, as you refer to, the still life. And also you can't really quite say whether it's dystopian or comical or odd or whatever. It's just, it almost escapes definition within the show, and it's the painting just at the back called It's That Miracle, which is, it seems slightly a one-off within the show. It seems slightly, you know, and I just wonder whether you can tell us, because we had long discussions about the title, the show titles, went from the kind of sublime to the ridiculous.
I think mine were the sublime.
Yeah, most often there was sort of ridiculous, I think. Yeah. But in the end, it was like this, I won't say compromise, but something that I think it was quite measured in trying to say something, you know, sort of meaningfully about how the show's been.
I think we kind of, in terms of giving the show a title, we kind of decided to, we'd talked ourselves to a halt, we kind of couldn't agree, and we're just going to call them John Greenwood Paintings, which is kind of really quite dull. And I think we wanted something catchier. I think that Scott suggested, well, actually, that, if you kind of just read that, it might get your attention. John Greenwood Paintings, if you don't know John Greenwood and you're not interested in painting, you're not necessarily going to, you know, read the next section. So just to have a title with a little bit more catchy.
And where, I mean, tell us A about painting, but also where did that title come from?
I made it up, as far as I know. It's actually really quite bizarre within this whole thing that it's an image that is by far the oldest image that I've got. It's the time when I didn't make images, when I was, you know, still at college, kind of doing abstract futurist kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And I remember just kind of feeling quite sad one day, and just drew the ancestor of that image, which was an object just hanging from a wooden structure that was just floating in the darkness. And I just kind of noted it down. It kind of came from nowhere. It's not then that started a kind of, it was the first point, but probably about 10 years where I started working like that. And it just came with this title, and I kind of wanted, is it an oxymoron? Where you kind of internally contradict each other. The idea of, again, the positive, the negative, the laughter and the darkness, that kind of thing. And it was at a time when my parents were living in the Channel Islands. I didn't really know anybody there. I used to go home for holidays, and I just kind of felt a long distance from anything and anybody, and I just thought that kind of image was from that. And it just, it's always been there. One day I thought, I'll do that one day, but it was never kind of the right time. And then within this show, it kind of seemed to fit, where the busier images, the images where I think, because you'd pointed out to me how often I use the box and how I use the box, I thought, sod it, I'm going to not use the box. And
is that what happened there? Are they still using
the box? No, they're all on the box. Except on the other side of that. So I brought this thing back and changed it slightly. This wooden structure, but, you know, became balloons, it seemed more relevant, and that thing then kind of feeds
took, you know, from some of the other.
And when you say you had an image from back then, was it like a mental image, or was it like an actual drawing that you'd made, sort of that you worked from?
I put it down as a drawing. I don't know how I got there. I don't remember it. If I think back, when I was about 16, I was doing my A-levels. I went up and did a course in transcendental meditation, and I remember doing this first instance where they kind of teach you and talk you through it. And I just remember kind of sitting and just thinking in my head that there was a dustbin suspended off some balloons, and I think I probably wasn't taking the process seriously. But I think that's kind of that idea of two things opposing. Possibly, again, that would have been 4 or 5 years before I came up with that imagery. You know, so I think that might be where the image came from. It just gets stored and then kind of changed a bit. And when I used sketchbooks, I must have just noted it in one corner and thought, I quite like that. But it didn't fit. It isn't how I worked. So I kind of never did anything with it. And then, yes, as I say, I kind of warmed it up and did it with it now.
It's a really interesting little expression called the horror vacui. Do you know that? The fear of emptiness. Mm-hmm. And I wonder whether occasionally you must feel sufficiently at peace with yourself that you can produce this. And also the one in Cardiff, which was called Father. Now that's what I'm saying, that there is space, there's air, even though it's in this enclosed space. Mm-hmm. And this one, as you're saying, you've actually taken the walls away, right? Mm-hmm. But in many of them, you get the feeling that they disturb you, but it's almost like you're packing more and more in. And whether that fills up the space so these things can't get out or they can't move or whatever, but then for me, there's a sense that these things are imprisoned, and the more stuff that's inside there, the less they're going to be able to move and shiver and wiggle and all the rest of it. And then occasionally, you know, something like this, or the father in Cardiff turns up, and it's in a completely different register.
Well, I think I intentionally did that. I mean, but I think it was a sense, because everything else has that fullness, which I think is my tendency. Like, I sometimes kind of think, all right, I'll do, you know, just a simple image, and then I just kind of, it just grows, and I enjoy that process of it growing. And I think the problem is a horror vacuum or whatever vacuum, you know, it's the sense, I've realised I could never be a minimalist. I think it's just not in my temperament, but I would automatically just keep on throwing more and more stuff in.
But it's interesting because not only are these things absolutely full of stuff, but they're all equally, there's nothing which is really shadowed enough so that it's disappearing. Or everything is having to say what it is, isn't
it? In fact, there's
no shadows. It's all very full on, isn't it?
There's a kind of shadow in the space, but the objects themselves don't tend to have shadows. There's like somebody was describing it as local colour, you know, where the colour is not affected by what it's next to or the kind of light that is sort of shortening it and the shadows. It's actually quite abstract in a strange sense, because although it looks representation, it's not really the objects themselves are not following rules, you know. The space is following rules, frighteningly, to the point that on a couple of occasions somebody has kind of looked at the lighting of the space and then looked at the painting and thought, you know, is that shadow being made by the light? You know, you can think, hello, you know.
Yeah.
So, but the objects themselves seem to not sort of follow the same rules.
I'm not aware of that. Maybe that's a failure of not done that intentionally. I like to think that they have, but I sometimes misunderstand the lighting. So if you've got a light that's kind of coming like this and an object in the middle, the shadows will be behind it. So, but it's actually quite interesting, the thought that what you might then be doing is trying to throw up a realistic space, and in a way then having objects which don't inhabit the space that you spend so much time trying to build. I think that's potentially an interesting thing to do.
But this is something we've talked about, isn't it? That you're using one point perspective, and one point perspective is an artificial space, isn't it? So all the time what you're doing is convincing us of the reality of this object, but the reality of the object can only exist within this one-point perspective. So it's invention and artifice right from the very beginning, isn't it? But what we were also talking a bit about Archimboldo recently, and do you know the composite heads, which are made up of various things? But what's really interesting about those heads is that the objects they're made from, even though you can actually discriminate between the objects, it's the whole has a sort of a visual importance or presence, I think, that slightly outweighs the objects that it's made of. You see the logic of the image.
Mm.
And I get the impression here that it's like these things, all the things that make it up, have a real problem with coming second to this monolithic donut-y thing. there's a fight on. I think there's always...
Maybe,
but there's often a fight on within the pictures themselves.
Could be. Yeah. It's not something I'm aware of, but to a certain degree that there's this... I suppose one of the concerns is this is the sense of things like in Archimboldo that you're pulling together which don't necessarily naturally fit together.
Yeah.
And also then the bits that don't get pulled together but are close by, the sense of, you know, that are separate from this, in a way, kind of central presence, and I suppose that there is the sense that that there's a gravitational pull, but there's also a pull outward, so that the object, I suppose, is
but it's
breaking
also,
apart.
It's also to do with a style of painting, isn't it? Which Archimboldo is using a slightly more blurred line than you. He's not using a very electric type of light, which you tend to use. But I've also pointed out to you when we had our correspondence during the summer that you endow this thing with light. The light all comes from you.
That's good, I like that. But again, because I mean, it's this sort of thing, I've really enjoyed that conversation, and I realise that, you know, I said that even thinking about Archimboldo comes because of that show that we were in Cardiff where Jill Briley's work had that kind of feeling to me.
And I
thought, that's peculiar that someone who, you know, is potentially should be one of the people I'm looking at the most. I've not looked at in 20 years. I've seen some of them somewhere, but I couldn't even remember what gallery I'd seen them in. I realise it's probably been removed because I'm not aware they're only in this country, I don't know.
Not that I know of.
But I'm aware I'd seen some, but just kind of walked past them as you kind of, you know. And I think that, so some of these conversations have had an influence. And I think because you talked about this idea of light, and also, I think one of the things that I've attempted to do with the works, I realise is that I love stillness in painting. I think often stillness suits painting more than anything else. Despite the fact half of what I do, none of which is really here, is often going to be as fast and as broken as possible. I kind of realise that the paintings I most enjoy looking at are often really, really simple. That there's a simple, you know, as much as I chuck everything in, I think the skill would be that someone like William Nicholson's still alive. So they're just absolutely just there. Everything, you know, you don't want to move anything. It's just perfectly quiet. And I think that's one of the things one of the reasons a long time ago I kind of thought, I want to do things that I kind of stopped, that carry with them a sense of peace. You might add a load of other stuff in. And I kind of realised having done this, and that being one of my interests, automatically I want to then break that. So I think that this work, different to what I've done before, and possibly as a reaction to where you'd kind of point to that idea that, you know, that you are creating the light and you are controlling this. It's all coming from outside, being kind of the gallery, you know, whatever, coming in. The one there, St. Anthony's Dance, starts to have the light in it. And I think, the far one, the third one. And also, that's true of the larger painting on the other side of that wall. I didn't just do it because of the conversation with you. I think it's been something I've been playing with. But the idea of bringing light into the painting so that the object isn't just this thing, in a way, I think it gives it more, potentially more life, but it makes it more disturbing. That this thing that is incapable of moving, that is encased, has something in it that's kind of fizzing and trying to fight its situation. I think that, you know, it's,
And that's new in a way, definitely.
But do you need to perhaps separate the ideas of it being static mm-hmm. and being calm and peaceful? Because when we say things,
I admire the calm and peaceful,
palette,
I don't think I do.
The palette is not restful, is it?
No. Well, no, not in that one. Maybe we should move. Maybe it's not in anything. But
I think what's interesting about these paintings is because the fact that they borrow conventions of what representations of the world, how they're made through painting, to suggest that it's a real thing that you're looking at. What we then forget is that, these are complete creations from, something that's in your mind to say something, rather than make those sort of illusions, kind of illusionistic sort of descriptions that would fall under more conventional still life painting.
Yeah.
And, for example, one of the things that I really liked about, what's the name of this painting from there?
Toying. if Carlsberg did perfection.
And it's the fact that, going back to what you were saying about stillness, and I think it's more than that in some ways. It's almost like it's capturing a moment, or perhaps a memory, when you see something like a toy, you feel frightened. The way that it's lit, to suggest that moment of temporary kind of, shock or whatever you want to call it, and in a sense that is much more precise than trying to say, these are objects and how many objects can I fit in, and there isn't anything that looks like that, but you've created it to, in some ways, create the drama mm-hmm. or the stage for that sort of that feeling that comes across in particular in that one.
And sort of following on from that is that when I talked to you, when I very first came to the studio, you do also make models as well, don't you?
I have done. I'm less so, I think, for these. It tends to be to capture the light, so I don't get lost shadows or something like that. But I make them less and less these days. So out of all of these, I don't think I made a model. I can't remember. Maybe. That one, based just the difficulty of how do you light balloons? What does a balloon through a balloon look like? Until I lit it, I couldn't work it out. So it's basically for the lighting, I think, more than anything. And it gives them. I think when I do bother to make models, the work that I get from it looks better. But often, I kind of can't be bothered. I want the painting finished. Spending an extra week.
I made a recent discovery that Bosch, apparently, because Bosch's family were all artists, but that he was also, he moved in a circle of painters who were also working with glassmakers, and that a lot of his forms actually come from the glass blowing and process.
Yeah.
Which is interesting because you look so much at Bosch.
Yeah. But again, it's a recent one. It's one of those people, Bosch and Darling, I've spent 30 years not looking at. I kind of felt that it was too easy to be sucked into their world. And I think that I felt more confident recently. I kind of felt my work doesn't look any longer too much like their work. I felt I'd learned how to be me well enough.
I suppose the point of making
that I could look at them. So especially this year, where this is Bosch's 500th anniversary, I did look, and there's my wife and I went over to the Bosch show, and I, it was absolutely brilliant. And I felt, it was like this kind of long lost relative going back to it, finding, you got just so much pleasure in looking at what he'd done, but not feeling that I'd come away and start to make Bosch's. But that said, I do find that he has his fountains in his work, and I, it's one of those things where I've kind of spent a while kind of building things up and realising that often did kind of three-part objects which are developing my work, with kind of things like arms and fruit hanging off them, and then you go and look at Bosch, and without having kind of seen it or thought about it for a long time,
there they were. You know, I guess that you can't do anything that doesn't look like something that already exists. And I did find it slightly disturbing, thinking I'd got the confidence to go back to him again, and finding that I was just, I'd either forgotten what he'd done or he'd already kind of covered it. And I don't know what those pieces are. They're obviously really, really important, but you know, they sit in the middle and at the back, somehow kind of organising his paintings. And I don't know what his intention is. They're not, I don't think anything in his painting is whimsy. I think they're doing something there, you know. But to me,
I think one of the things that came up, which was interesting in developing the Cardiff show that I curated, was that there are definitely some artists that you are on the edge of, who are making still life paintings, in inverted commas, purely from the process of the painting itself. And you're not quite that. You're inventing very specific things, but they don't actually engage with different textures and directions and layers of paint in a very physical sense. Sometimes they move towards the illusion of another sort of surface, don't they? Mm-hmm. So you're making invented things in painting. But the paint is not doing that much suggesting.
That's a failure of me as an artist, then.
Because it's where you're situated. And there may be another artist where the paint does an enormous amount of suggestion.
I would like to think I do. I'm aware that probably of all the things that when I start, making my next body of work, I'm aware, having spent so long looking at that flower show at the National Gallery, and how much you get these textures which are just kind of just reminiscent. I'm never quite sure of what they're. You know, if it's a pumpkin, it looks like a pumpkin.
Yeah.
But when you go and look at them, they just seem to be something else.
Mm-hmm.
And that is in the paint. It's in their layering system of their paint, it's in their glazing.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm kind of realising that there's an absolute fascinating world there that I'm on the edge of, I would love to use. And you know, if we had this conversation in a year's time, I'd like to say to you, you're wrong. But I think, sadly, you're probably right, and that's in a sense my failure as a painter. I'm not doing that enough.
I'm probably saying that a little bit clumsily. If we look at this painting here, whatever it is on the floor is suggestive of something that the viewer can relate to in some way.
Mm-hmm.
But it isn't because you're texturing the actual the physical paint or anything like that. It is, you are creating an invented illusion. It's not even an illusion of something in actuality.
Mm-hmm.
It's an interesting space to be in where you're inventing something which is very suggestive.
Yeah, I
think there's an interesting tension there, because especially now that we're in a sort of hyper digital age where you can actually render things that are not dissimilar through other means.
Hmm.
Sometimes I've shown these images to particular students, and they might say, I've heard the strangest things. I said, is that a sculpture? I said, is it a photograph? It's almost like the last thing that they will think is that somebody's actually bothered to paint it. Or maybe not even bothered to paint it, but being able to paint it. You know, that on the one hand, you've got this sort of madness thing, but it's actually been painted rather than created in a sort of Pixar or Photoshop.
It'd be quite interesting if I was a student now, would I be a painter? I think the answer is probably not. But I'm really glad that I am, because I think that they stand to a chance to be much better by being painted than someone could render them, some of the images, or I could have gone down that road and found that interesting.
Mm.
And I'm sure it would have had its own rewards. The thing is, when you've painted so long, I'm kind of battling to actually try and be a better painter.
Yeah.
And I'm very, very glad, and I think that so much of the area I want to explore is in within what paint can do. But interesting enough, often isn't done in this day and age, which is that something like glazing, which absolutely fascinates me, layering paint, I can't think of very many people who do it.
Mm.
But doesn't this go back to what you were talking about, the Boundary Road exhibition and the comment that was made to you by Glenda Dixonson, that you were different?
Mm.
That's it, isn't it? That's it.
Mm.
This isn't nostalgia for past art. But there's definitely...
There's a lot of nostalgia there. But
do you think there is?
I worry about that sometimes. I think, for example, within this, you know, one got me to take the frames off. I was doing these old, kind of, you know, modern, I was making them, but Dutch-like frame, or Italian frame. And I think they were pulling the art back.
Yeah, I think that's...
And I think that I don't want them to be, that's you know, I don't mind referencing them. But you want to be a painter of now, that somehow these images represent something about what it's like to live in this time.
Because you talk about being a raider and an appropriator, and you haven't talked at all about that, an aspect which was nostalgic.
Well, when I say nostalgia, I think just using old art, enjoying the illusionism of old art, that I like, you more readily get that illusionism in art that's the pre, what I think is the modern era, you know, kind of 1880s this way, that you know, I'm not saying all great art after, you know, before, after, but I'm drawn to that. I'm drawn to the way that there's something that when you can give a certain kind of life to these creations by allowing people to feel there's a space around them that they live in, and I enjoy that process. I think there's a nostalgia to going and looking at paintings and people who've done that and done it really well. It might not be nostalgia, but there's a sense of looking to the past and thinking, that was fantastic. Not better than now, not better than what's gone in between, but just enjoying, you know, it's another thing that you can use, another thing that you can chuck into your melting pot out of which you know, develop what you do.
Could you talk a little bit more perhaps about, for example, if you were given plasticine or clay and you had wonderful glaze technology at your fingertips and all the rest of it, you could make this. You could physically make it. What is the difference between making it and having it in a painting? So what I'm asking you is really, what is it apart from this that's in the painting? Can you talk about that?
Interesting thing is,
this air,
I would love
this space.
To be able to, I'd love to be able to, but I can't put my finger on it. And I think it's one of the absolute cruxes of what I enjoy in, for example, someone like, I want to call him Dahim, but you call me and say it's Dahim or Roy. But when you go and you look and you do that thing, as you say, that you go and look at paintings you've looked at 50 times before, and you just kind of look at another little section and you realise you get absorbed into it. But there's something that what they're painting isn't a flower. It's not there's something in it, and I don't know what it is, and I think it's the best quality about the painting, but if I had to use the word, I'd say it becomes metaphysical, but I think it's probably completely the wrong use of the word. It dissolves into something that just has a kind of, I was going to say a physical reaction to it, but I'm quite sure it's a mental reaction, that there's something in my mind that sees these worlds and just goes, yes, that's just fantastic. And it's not its mimicry. It's making something that either doesn't exist or has a poetry that links it to memories, to textures of varying things without ever being any of them. And I don't know what that is, and I can't. I was talking to a friend about it and battling, and every time I tried to describe it, I just realised I wasn't talking about it. I wasn't, you know, I don't know what it is. It's fascinating to me. And if I was to build those things accurately and beautifully, they would completely, utterly lack that quality. I said to you once that, you know, that thing where you sometimes see people who stage old Dutch still lives and they photograph them completely mimicry, and it completely, utterly kills the magic. I wasn't talking about one of your artists, because I'm not saying that you can't get wonderful still life photographs, but when you take an old painting and restage it in exactly the same light, what's interesting is how uninteresting it is.
Carters, there's a couple.
I don't know.
And Sharon Corr, for example, they are people who are doing that now, and they're doing them as exquisite digital prints, and it's art.
I mean, in your first catalogue, in your first exhibition, there were some Dutch photographers on still line, which I thought the work was really interesting. But that's not what I'm talking about. It's that sense that when they literally go and get the same flower and put it in the same place, and something deathly about them.
I think what it is about these, and again, correct me if I'm wrong, is that they look like still lifes. They seem to follow some of the conventions of painting objects in still lifes, but they're not about still lifes. You know, they're about, if anything, they're much more about people. They're much more about relationships and conflicts and mad thoughts that pop into your head that you shouldn't tell someone, or, you know, things that distract you, or, you know, things in your peripheral vision, things that you find funny about the world and people within that world. But you use the appearance, I think, of these paintings, because in some ways it makes that much more interesting than if you did like some paintings of people falling over and stumbling and sort of poking each other.
We've talked a lot about them as big still lifes. I think you're dead right, because they're not, I think, traditional still lifes. I look often at old art and that is still lifes and borrow from that, but I think you're right. I think they're more, if they're about anything, it's that sense of being, it's probably a bit too grand, of what it's like to be a person relating to other people here and now, and making things that attempt to play on that while quite are aware of their own failure. You can't do that in a painting. You know, people aren't like that. But I think that's what I'd like to do.
When you talk about this business of here and now, isn't that exactly what you mean when you see those old paintings that you are amazed by? Mm. But the excess that you talk about, the thing which is more than the flower itself, is partly the individual who's painted them, and all those things to do with their particular body and the type of gestures they do and all the rest of it. But it is also very much to do with the time at which they're painted, because all art is temporally specific, isn't it? Even if you do something which may be quite traditional in certain approaches, you cannot help but make a picture which is of its own time.
Yeah, no, I think so. Yeah, even if you tried not to, it wouldn't
And
be.
The light here is particularly indicative.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I've nearly had enough
talking. I'm sure Johnston's enough, had enough talking. And
anybody else can talk? I mean, if anybody else has got ideas, it doesn't have to be a question. I'd rather talk.
All right. So, thank you.
I think it's quite helpful to remember what that lunatic, the Kiriko, said after he kicked the, after he lost the magic, after he stopped painting those wonderful. And he began to do the pastiche still lifes and the pastiche musketeers and all those sort of subjects. He, in his grand way, said, I do not call them still lives. I call them silent lives.
Well, I think there is an element. One of my interest in the word, I think when I call them my still lives, it is that sense of stilling life. I think that's the. So it's not just a description of, you know, a collection of objects. It's the idea that you're trying to capture, you know, something that's complicated and flowing. For some reason, I don't know why you attempt to do this, but I think that's probably, you know, one of my grander attempts is that that's what you're trying to do, really.
So, yeah. Vite silente.
What?
Vite silente.
What's the Dutch term?
I was going to say, our use of still is borrowed from still leven, which is still in Dutch is more like dead. So it's dead life. So actually it's an oxymoron in itself, which is quite interesting.
There's another one. There's another term they use.
There was one.
Still even, is it?
Sorry?
Still even.
Still leven.
Still leven.
Yes.
No, it's not still life. It reads as still even.
Not really a question, it's more like an observation. When you say about stillness and still life, I was mostly, they also the attention on the surface, the background, like in Morandi, or it's not the same painting, because Morandi is, there's this kind of thing sitting on an horizontal surface, and then the attention is to the surface. And but about is very your work, I think, for me, it's not more like portraiture, that portrait, because it seems to be very, most of the one I'm looking here, center, like the nose in the middle, and they look a bit like faces. But what I think is different there is the notion of scale, in the sense that these things you create could be that scale, and I'm just going to take it in that box and I can hold it in my hands. Mm. But in the meantime, like in my imagination, they can be much bigger. And at the beginning, I was thinking, why we should, maybe we could make them like big sculpture, like this one a bit like, Louise Bourgeois sings, you know, with all these things, and these breaths, and in the meantime, I think it's, in fact, it's better you don't, because then, you know, what would you paint them if they become really, you know, objects of use one.
The interesting thing is that I used to make these paintings, certainly one like that one there. I mean, you're looking at the two that are the most head-like, I think, here. So, but that one, I used to do those, and they used to be 6 foot across. Yeah. And these take me, the first one I did took 6 months to paint, and you become completely bored by the end of it. And I think by shrinking them down, what's interesting is that's, in my head, is often still the same size.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I think I'm hoping that at times, not in all of them, there's an invitation to choose your own scale.
Mm-hmm.
They happen to be this big, but in a way, a bit like kind of, you know, hopefully there's a richness enough there that you come up close, and at that point, the picture changes, you're not looking.
Yeah, because with Archibaldo, a foot is a foot, so an apple, you know what size you have.
Yes. Yes, well, that, I guess that the head size.
Yeah.
But do you think this is right, actually? Because I've thought about this as well. It's actually, I think that they are more or less head size, because if they were huge, you would have to stand much further away from them. And the way our vision is trained, you would then not see them in so much detail. And the fact that you see every tiny detail means, or it implies to our type of vision now, that you're very close up. If you're that close up and you're seeing it like that, actually, you're probably there. That makes it very claustrophobic and
yeah,
very
but then
intense.
I think that hopefully then encourages you in your mind to see
yes,
it as you've got
yes.
the detail that potentially you're looking at something that big from that far away, so that it's hopefully moves, so it's not static.
That enters the territory then of illusion leading to imagining and imagination, doesn't it?
Yeah.
But it's very different, isn't it? That sort of, as soon as you put something in one-point perspective, you make the rules, you're in complete control of something.
But you can have a big box that's in one-point perspective or a little box.
Yeah, but all I'm saying is that it. How big the painting is in one-point perspective also dictates how far away you are to see the whole painting in actuality, but also in the representation itself. There are certain implications. We know, because we're used to cameras and all the rest of it, that if you're further away from something, and we're even going back to Leonardo and aerial perspective, you know, that it would be slightly more fuzzy around the edges. And because these are so detailed, these comply very much with the early modern type of still life, because everything is desperately in focus.
I think something's also, you know, through the change of scale in the work, something kind of more fundamental has happened in that. I mean, some of these, the actual objects could almost be elements of previous larger works, you know. So if you imagine like an older work, you know, 6 foot across, you would have had several of these objects across.
Yeah.
You know, which is very exciting, but then, you know, like you say, it takes 6 months to make, and it becomes like a kind of epic kind of battle against the painting. Whereas through narrowing down your kind of relationship to the work and saying, I'm going to make this more or less essentially, although there's lots of little things going on, it's one thing in a box. In some ways, I think that's allowed to also then reconnect your kind of enjoyment with the work, which I think is kind of very important. And that in itself is then manifesting itself, you know, in use of colour perhaps, or the kind of the sort of general feeling that we get from the work. And I'm saying that as I'm sort of suddenly thinking about this one, how does that relate to enjoyment? Anyway, so, but you know, generally speaking, with some of those works, you know, you do get a sort of something new happening in the work. I mean, they're still your works, but there's something, it's like something has, sort of blossomed in this sort of manifestation.
Yeah. I think that the fact that you can make them quick and move on to the next one allows you to keep a level of excitement for longer. Good and true.
Is there a story as you're making these things? Is there like a little narrative, a sort of, oh, and then you do this, and then maybe you hire that?
I wouldn't want to take that away from you as a reader, but that's not how I tend to think of it, no. I don't think so, no. I mean, you know, one of the questions I sometimes get asked is it partly narrative painting?
Yeah.
I find it a very hard thing to answer, because that term seems to be quite a broad one. That, you know, to have anything that was recognisable in the 60s was considered narrative. It didn't necessarily have to mean
here's a story. I don't consider this a story. I'd be really happy if people make one. You know, I wouldn't want to take that away, you know, from you when you're looking at that in your living room. Mm. Of, oh, this does that to that. I would encourage that. And I may occasionally do that myself, but that's not essentially the, what I think is going on.
Is there hidden meaning?
Sorry?
Is there hidden meanings for you in the paintings? Like,
I mean,
and these like kind of cold spaces, and then there's these warm, kind of exciting, alive objects. I mean, it seems like there could be like hidden elements to a lot of it. They're quite sexual,
mm-hmm.
even kind of like sadomasochist, some of them, you know, like there's a lot of different things going there, but it's not completely obvious screaming out. So like maybe like you're hiding all these little things that you think were entertaining.
Sounds good. I like that reading. I'm not going to go into it, because my family's here, including my in-laws. But there we go. So, yeah. No, but great.
I think that's a perfect spot to finish, unless anybody else is going to come. And just so I say, thank you, Frances. Thank you for a wonderful text. John, thank you for letting us show your paintings at Turps. And thank you all for coming here today.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.